Welcome everybody to SQL Friday. This is SQL Friday number 15. Our star today is Nikola Ilic, who will present Magnificent 7 Simple Tricks to Boost Your Power BI Development. Nikola did his first conference presentation on New Stars of Data, and that was just a few weeks ago. And if you didn't attend New Stars of Data, just go to www.newstarsofdata.com and check out the recordings. All the speakers on New Stars of Data are new speakers. They were all mentored by seasoned data platform speakers, MVPs, and what have you. It was William Durkin and Ben Wiseman who's organized New Stars of Data, and I think it was an amazing initiative. And one of the stars from New Stars of Data is Nikola, who is with us today. As always, SQL Friday presentations are being recorded and they're put on YouTube, and they will be accessible from sqlfriday.net. If you have any questions during the presentation, please do not unmute yourself and just talk, because it becomes a bit messy when everybody talks over each other's voices. Instead, post the messages or the questions in the chat window, and I will relay them to Nikola as we go along. That is it when it comes to introduction. And whenever you're ready, Nikola, stage
is yours. I'm ready, Magnus. Thanks. First of all, thanks for the gentle introduction and for mentioning New Stars of Data. It was such a great experience for me and for other new speakers also. Okay, I will now start to share my screen. Going straight into the action. Hope that you can see my screen now.
I can see your screen. Perfect.
Okay, great. Then, hi everybody, good day, or maybe better to say bon appetit to all of you who are watching this session during your lunch time. Welcome to SQL Friday also from my side. And thanks, Magnus, for having me. It's really an honor and pleasure to speak here in the company of true data experts who presented so far and will present in the future. Today, we will have a lot of fun with Power BI, so I want you to welcome to my session Magnificent 7 Simple Tricks to Boost Your Power BI Development. Hope that you will enjoy. Before we start, let me just briefly introduce myself. My name is Nikola Ilic. I'm originally from Belgrade, Serbia, but since last 4 years, I live in a wonderful city of Salzburg in Austria, where I work as a business intelligence developer at company ITSP Services. Living in Salzburg was the reason why I've chosen my nickname Data Mozart, as Salzburg is worldly known as a birthplace of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Therefore, I was brave enough to use his last name as part of my nickname. And that's why my motto is make music from your data. I'm regularly blogging at data-mozart.com, and I'm also pretty active on LinkedIn and Twitter, so feel free to connect or ping me if you like. A few more sentences about me. I have multiple year experience working with data products, mostly with the Microsoft Data Platform. Started with SQL Server, then brushed myself with analysis services, multidimensional reporting services, integration services, and most recently with Power BI. So I'm a big fan of Power BI. Privately, I'm a father of two kids and a true football and Barca fan, as you can conclude looking at the photo on the slide. Let's talk about prerequisites. Well, this is a 200 level session, which means intermediate level. Don't be scared and don't run away if you are new to Power BI, as I will walk you through step by step how everything is created. Of course, some basic knowledge and experience with Power BI can come in handy, but you are not in trouble if you've never used Power BI before. Most of the topics relate to visualization techniques, so walking through the session with no programming background is completely fine. As I said, no Power BI experience is needed, but it would obviously help. And the most important thing for those who were asking themselves if they can sneak through the session without understanding any DEX, yes, of course, so don't leave the session because of lack of DEX knowledge. Honestly, there will be some DEX involved in few examples, but it will be on a really, really basic level, so everyone can understand what we are doing. In any case, if someone doesn't understand, feel free to ask a question and I will try to answer the best I can. Okay, one more thing before we dive into the real fun with Power BI. I would like to find out a little more about you and what kind of audience is with us today. Since we are going virtual and I can't ask you to raise your hands, may I then kindly ask you to fill the poll by answering to one simple question. What is your Power BI level of expertise? I will put the link to a poll in the chat section and give you maybe 1 minute to fill the poll. So I think link is visible now.
It's visible.
Okay. While we are waiting, let me just quickly walk you through agenda. We will see how to turn plain matrix visual to a custom visual, then how to show selected slicers on your report canvas. Then we will talk about tooltip pages and as a bonus tip, animated tooltip page. Then we will see how to dynamic filter our measures to show them in one visual. Then displaying totals in stacked column visual, which is a cool trick. Then how to use buttons and actions for drilling through to a specific drill through pages. And finally, we will see how to reset all your slicers with one single click. Okay, let me just check quickly for the poll. Okay, thank you everyone for taking part in the poll. And okay, so interesting responses. We have all kind of audience here. Okay, so let's start our Power BI journey today. The first thing I want to show you is so simple yet powerful that I thought it's well worth including it in this presentation. So first of all, I have to admit that Power BI has extremely large collection of visuals, both built-in and especially custom visuals from App Source Marketplace. And one of the built-in visuals that is frequently used is plain old matrix visual. Those of us who are old enough and used to work with SQL Server reporting services, yeah, we have fond memories of matrix. It was a key pillar of our reports. But matrix as a visual was underrated in Power BI for a long time. And even well-known expand-collapse functionality was enabled just less than a year ago, I think somewhere in the end of 2019. Do you recognize this, let me zoom it a little bit, this illustration here? Yes, no? For those of you who are not familiar, it's from Google Analytics dashboard. It's quite simple, but at the same time powerful. Basically, it gives you a quick insight in the most relevant trends. However, believe it or not, Power BI doesn't offer out-of-the-box visual that would bring the same experience. So now I will show you how you can transform plain old matrix visual to something like a heat map visual, but even more customized. So it should mimic the look and feel of the Google Analytics visual you just saw. As I like to say when I'm demoing this trick, after we are done, you can freely say that you created your own custom visual. Well, enough talk. It's show time. So let's head over to Power BI desktop. Let's say that our business scenario is to show total sales amount per month for every single brand. That's pretty common business request, I would say. So I have a matrix, I have sales amount, months as a columns, and brands as a rows. As you can notice, there are a lot of numbers, but it's really hard to spot the trends without spending some additional time to going into more deeper analysis. Okay, so let's go to work. I will go to conditional formatting. And first thing I need to format is the background color property. So let me zoom it a little bit here under background color. As soon as I turned it on, Power BI automatically applied some gradual coloring, but I want more control over it and to customize it to follow the general design of my report. So I'm going to advanced controls and I will choose color scale from this light blue to this dark blue. Okay, so numbers are still there. So next thing we need to do is to apply the same formatting for font color property. So straight under background color is font color property. Again, turn it on and go to advanced controls and just applying this same color pattern. And here it is. So in literally a few clicks, we transformed plain old matrix to a modern looking custom visual. And that's really cool. This way we enabled our users to easily spot that, for example, Contoso and Fabricam sales hit their best between May and July, and also that worst month of Contoso, which is January, is better than the best month of any other brand except Fabricam. And the most important thing, we could easily spot those trends in literally 2 seconds without getting deeper into the numbers. Of course, numbers are still there, and if we want to check some specific figures, tooltip will do the job. So for example, if I hover over August, I will see that sales amount for Contoso was something above $70 million. In all fairness, I need to say, don't blindly use this trick for every metrics in your report, as there will still be many more scenarios where you want to stick with traditional way of displaying data. However, you will definitely face some situations when this technique can be beneficial. And if you ask me, when would I use this trick, I would say in wide matrices with a lot of numbers like this one in our example. And applying this trick in those situations would definitely enrich your user's experience. Okay, going back to presentation, number two is showing selected slicers. Well, this trick came out after I previously presented my session at New Stars of Data conference. And one of the questions I received during the session was, is there a way to show the actual active filters as a result of the slicer choices on our report page? And while preparing the answer, I realized that, in fact, a lot of people were searching for the solution to this challenge. So I decided to explain today in details how you can achieve this. Basically, the problem we're trying to solve here is when we have multiple slicers in our report and multiple selection enabled within those slicers, our users can easily get lost and don't know exactly what affects their numbers and charts. Therefore, we need to display in the report itself which values have been selected in the slicers. First and most important thing, DAX is your friend. We will learn about iterator functions and how can you benefit from using them to solve this specific challenge. In the end, I will also share with you a bonus tip which will even more improve your user's experience. So enough talking, it's showtime again. Let's go to Power BI Desktop. You can notice three slicers on the report canvas, and let's say that I want to show my users which brands are selected within brand slicers. So it's Contoso, Literant, Northwind Traders, but they don't know it until they click on the slicer. Okay, so the first step is to create a DAX measure that will capture all selected values in the slicer. You can use two different DAX functions to obtain distinct values from a column values function or distinct function. Just let me lay a short theoretical background before we do the job in the report. So values function is more complex since you can use both table name and column name as its argument. But here we will focus on the column name as an argument. Basically, values will return all distinct values from the column we passed, including blanks, if blanks exist. On the other hand, distinct will return all distinct values, but ignoring blank values. So in 99% of situations, they will behave exactly the same. Which one you want to use depends mostly on the business requests, if your users want to see numbers for blanks or not. Personally, I prefer to use values because it gives me the full picture. So let's create our measure. I will call it selected brands. And it equals, so we are using values function. And because brand name column from product table is within our slicer, we want to return all distinct values from this column. I will now put this measure on the report canvas. Let's use table visual and put selected brand. Oops, that gives me an error. But however strange it sounds, it's okay. I know now you're thinking, Nikola, are you crazy? How on earth can error be okay? For the starter, let's see the error message and what it's specified in error message. I will zoom it a little bit. So a table of multiple values was supplied where a single value was expected. The problem is that that measure expects single value, not a table, and the values function, like such as distinct function, will return a table instead of single value. However, that's not a normal table; it's a virtual table created on the fly by DAX engine. So we should apply some additional steps and calculations in order to extract single values from it. And here come iterator functions to the rescue. Iterator functions do exactly what their name says. They iterate over the table and apply the calculation row by row. So how can you recognize iterator functions? They have X letter in the end. So it's sum X, average X, count X, etc., etc. In our scenario, we need to iterate over our distinct values and concatenate them into our string, which will be later displayed in the report. To achieve that, we will use concatenate X function. This function accepts three arguments. The first is a table that we want to iterate on, which is in our case a virtual table created by using values function. Then expression we are applying row by row. And finally, the limiter we want to use for separating extracted values. It will be much more clear once I rewrite our measure. So let's use concatenate X function. And the first argument, as I said, is this virtual table. The second is the expression we want to return. So we want to return a brand name. And the third argument is the limiter. I'm using comma, but you can use semicolon or whatever you want. Now let's confirm this measure. And when I look again at my report, I will see my selected brands display here. So once I change selection here within the slicer, let's say I exclude Northwind Traders. So you see now only Contoso and Litware are displayed here. You can combine, of course, multiple slicer selection here. So let's create another measure following the same pattern. And I will call it selected year to capture the year selection. And it will, again, look similar. So first argument is our table, which is in this case dates year. The second argument, we want to return dates year. And the third one, again, delimiter. Okay, so selected year. Let's drag this also to our table. And now you see, sorry about that. Two commas, that's the problem. Okay, now you see that in my table, I can see both selected brands and selected year next to each other. And stay with me, here is a bonus trick which will even more impress your users. If you have many slicers in your report, let's say 4, 5, 6, and you want to display all of the selections, but you don't want to waste space on your report canvas or bloating your report with this visual, which is, in all honesty, not directly related to a data, you can create a bookmark containing the table with all selected values and then just display the bookmark on user's request. And let me show how it's done. So now I will remove this table because I already prepared one which is nicer and formatted. So I will turn on under view tab. So here under view tab, let's turn on bookmarks and selection pane so we get control of what is going on our report canvas. And the first thing I'm going to do is to create a bookmark. I will call it slicer pane hidden. Okay, so that's how my report will look like when the slicer pane is not selected. So you might want to turn off data properties so that slicers aren't reset when users switch views by selecting a bookmark. Okay, now the second one, I will show those two tables. This is the naming problem, I think. Selected year. Okay, so yeah, you can see that it's exactly the same table, just a formatted one to look a little bit nicer. So that's how my report will look like when my slicer pane is shown on the report. So I'm adding bookmark to capture this page status, again, turning off data. And let's call it slicer pane displayed. Okay. final touch is to define actions for our icons so that user can navigate between the bookmarks. So I'm clicking on this close window icon, going to action. Let me zoom it a little bit. So going to action and choosing my slicer pane hidden. So once I click on this icon, the table will disappear. Now I need to define action for this button to navigate me again back to my slicer pane displayed. And now when I click on it, yeah, I see that it works fine. As you may notice, we found quite straightforward solution to a common problem. Combination of DEX iterator functions and bookmarks in the end produced a fully functional solution. And your users will love you because you provided them with the possibility to see which filters affect their numbers and charts, at the same time saving space on the report canvas to accommodate more visuals or to give a little more space to existing ones.
Okay, going back. Kai is asking if you could show the DAX formula once more.
Yeah, sure. DAX formula for, I guess, for this, select the brands. So it's concatenate X iterator function, then virtual table, which is created by using values function, then the column, which is in the slicer, and the last one is delimiter. So instead of comma, you can use whatever delimiter you want. Colon, semicolon, exclamation mark, whatever.
Perfect. Kai looks happy. So.
Okay, awesome. Great. Oh, great. We are at topic number three already. Now I would like to show you some neat techniques on how you can enhance your reports using tooltip pages. Well, first of all, I have to say that I really consider Power BI as an awesome tool because it gives you flexibility to tell the data story in multiple different ways. It's really about your creativity, and with little tweaking here and there, you can give your users much better insight into the underlying data. And they will appreciate that, I assure you. So tooltips are quite useful feature in the Power BI report. By default, when you hover over a visual, let's say data bar, like in our example on this slide, you will see numbers for that specific portion of data. But what happens when default is not good enough, or when we want to give our users better insights into the data with just hovering over data bars? So it's showtime again. Let's switch over to Power BI desktop. Okay, so here I have, I will first turn off this selection bookmarks panes because we don't need it for this example. I already prepared two tooltip pages in advance, so we don't need to waste time building everything from scratch, but I will walk you through all the necessary steps for building tooltip page from zero, I promise. So the first one is tooltip regions, which basically shows consists of one card visual showing total sales quantity and top five regions by sales amount sorted in descending order. The second one is tooltip colors, which shows top five colors for every specific brand. Well, first step when creating tooltip page is to click on this small plus sign here down at the bottom. And we need to define a few things in formatting panes. So first, in page size property, instead of default 16:9, I will choose tooltip. And next thing I prefer to do is going to view tab, and under page view, I'm choosing actual size. Why I'm doing this? Because that will help me to build visualizations in proportions to a real size of the tooltip page. I will also make this page hidden so that users don't see it when they open the report. And one last step is to instruct Power BI that we want to use this page as a tooltip. So go to page information and turning on this tooltip option here. So just turn that on. So now Power BI recognizes and knows that we want to use this page as a tooltip page. I'll do the same for this already created two tooltip pages. So under page information, I will turn that tooltip on. And for tooltip colors, do the same. Now going back to my main report, and let's say that I want to include my tooltip page here for this table. Now, when I hover over it, as you see, you can see default tooltip showing me numbers for that specific month in total. So what we need to do is going to formatting pane, going to tooltip, and that's important. So under type, instead of default, choose report page. Tooltip regions is the page I want to show here. So now when I hover over, let's say, March 2009, I'll see my tooltip page for this month. And when I continue to hover over different rows, I see that numbers are changing to reflect the underlying data. Let's do something similar here for sales amount by brand name. Now we have default tooltips. We'll do the same, go to formatting pane, under tooltip, instead of default, I will choose tooltip colors. And once when I go back, I see numbers for Litware broken down by color, and I see numbers for Contoso also broken down by color. Okay, so now you're probably asking yourself, why did I create two different tooltip pages? Yeah, I could show you everything with one example, and that's a great question. So let me answer it. Choosing default tooltip page size is not the only option. So you can also create a tooltip page using custom size, entering values you want based on your specific needs and what kind of insight you want to express in the tooltip. So here under page size, instead of choosing tooltip, you can also choose a custom size and then defined you define the width and height of this specific page according to your needs. Okay, now stick with me. I'll give you one bonus tip, and it's really level pro. So first of all, credits go to Jason Cockington from acceleratorbi.com. Jason explains this trick in details, but I was so impressed that I want to show you quickly here today. What is it about? Basically, a lot of our report users are often unaware of some capabilities within Power BI and need some kind of guidance in order to use the report in its full capacity. So previously, I was using this trick to instruct my user how to use drill through feature within Power BI. But since we recently got specific button action for drill through, which you will see in one of the next demos, this trick can be adjusted to assist in some other scenarios. And let's say that I want to instruct my users how to use analyze feature of the visual. By default, this feature is not visible to users. They need to right click on the visual, like I will do now. And you see here, analyze, and then explain the decrease or increase depending on the specific data point in the visual. So it's not so intuitive. Now I created a GIF containing all necessary steps to perform analyze on this visual. And there are a lot of free GIF creators on the web. I'm using ezgif.com, and I already created before this session. So I will just walk you through the steps for creating animated tooltip page using your GIF. So basically, all steps remain the same. Therefore, I will use this page one, which I already created. All steps remain the same. The main thing is under page background, I want to add an image. So here, you have option to add image for your background. I will add my GIF. Nothing changed at the moment because of this property here, transparency. Now I will set it to 0 and set image fit to fill. And you see short animation that instructs my user how to use analyze feature. Now going back to my main report, and I want that my user, when he hovers over this question mark, instead of seeing default tooltip, I want him to see this animated GIF. So I'm going to formatting pane, and under visual header, visual header tooltip, okay. I will choose page one, okay? And now when I hover over the question mark, I see my short animation, which helps my user to understand how to use analyze feature. And that's really cool. Before we conclude this topic, let me go back one step and stress again this, don't get crazy with creating too many tooltip pages, since it will affect overall report performance because of longer rendering time. As I often like to say, try to find the right balance between giving your users enhanced experience and additional overhead, which can be caused by overusing some of the non-standard techniques. Okay, so let's continue our hopefully interesting journey on Power BI tips and tricks. Next topic is dynamic filtering in Power BI. And the challenge we're trying to solve is that we want to give our users possibility to dynamically choose what they want to see in the report. Or to be more specific, they should be able to switch between different measures in the same visual in most effective way. The first solution that came to my mind while trying to solve this was to play around with the buttons and bookmarks. But then I thought, what if in the future my users wish to expand on this and include some additional measures? I mean, it's not a problem and you need to provide selection between two or three options, but things quickly become more complex if you use bookmarks and need to increase the number of possible outcomes. Therefore, even if I love bookmarks, I discarded them as a possible solution, since I thought it would create a real headache when it comes to maintenance. I will now show you a much more flexible solution, which can be created pretty quick, and what's most important, can be quickly upgraded to support additional similar requests. So we are getting flexibility and scalability in one solution. Both nice things, so who doesn't like that? Okay, so it's showtime. Let's go to Power BI Desktop again. I already prepared some basic stuff, as you can see. I also created a few simple measures we will need for this demo. And I'm using explicit measures. I know that we all like things that are automatically created for us, and Power BI is pretty good in it, but without going any deeper now, I would just say that you should avoid using implicit measures whenever possible and create explicit measures instead. So here are my measures. First one is sales amount, which is just simple sum over sales amount column. And the second one is sales amount year to date, which uses calculate function over this previously sales amount measure, and built-in time intelligence DEX function dates year to date, which will help me to calculate running totals for the selected year. Now let me drag these measures to the table just to check if everything works fine. So I will zoom it a little bit. The first column shows me sales amount broken down by month, you see. And the second one shows me sales amount year to date, so aggregating all previous values. Now the thing we are trying to achieve is to enable our users to select only one of these measures in their report, not both at the same time. So now I will remove them. Okay. And the first thing I need to do is to create a new table, which will hold data for our dynamic filter. So go to enter data. And I will call this table calculation timeframe. I need two columns. Basically, one will be enough, but this ID column I like to use because if you want to sort your data different than alphabetically, then you can use this ID column for that. And I have monthly or year-to-date selection. As you see, we use only two different options here, but in the future, you can easily expand this and add many, many more additional records. So I load this to a data model. Okay, so I need to capture user selection so that I know which measure to display to her or him. So let's create a measure which will capture the user selection. I'm going to calculation timeframe, new measure, and let's call it selected timeframe. It equals mean, so we are using mean function. Calculation timeframe ID. This measure will return minimum ID value of the user selection. In case that no value is selected, the measure will return ID 1 by default, which is monthly in our case. So by default, monthly values will be displayed in our table. Now stick with me, here is where the magic happens. So far we have captured user selection, but it's still in some way disconnected from our existing data model. So let's see how can we put user selection into the context of our whole data model. I'm going back to my fact table, creating a new measure, which I will call sales amount selected. And it equals, we will use switch function. I want to return selected time frame. And I say, if it's one, return me sales amount. If it's two, return me sales amount year to date, closing brackets. And for the sake of proper naming, let's remove those table prefixes from our measures. Let me stop here for a second and explain what is so special about this measure. It takes, as I said, it takes ID value from user selection and based on that value, display respective calculation with help of switch function. In simple words, if user chooses ID 1, which is monthly, return me sales amount value. If he chooses number 2, which is year to date, then return me sales amount year to date. Okay, and final touch is to create a slicer here, which will enable users to select what they want to see in their visual. So I will put slicer on my report and I will put period here. Let's do a little formatting to make it nicer. Okay, and let's drag our final measure sales amount selected to our table. So as you can see, by default, we see monthly values. So all values are broken down on month level. But as soon as I click on year to date, the numbers are changed and they're showing me running totals. Again, click on monthly and I'm going back to see numbers per month, year to date, showing me running total. Now, this was just a basic example of using this technique, but you can virtually implement it in multiple different scenarios and it will work perfectly. This pattern basically gives an amazing amount of flexibility to use the same visual and look at different metrics within the same visual. And this removes the need for bookmarks and more visuals for every single calculation. Okay, so let's head over to next topic, which is displaying totals in stacked column chart visual. I really like this trick. The main problem here is that by default, there is no possibility to display totals in stacked column chart visual. And since the stacked column chart is one of the most common used visuals in Power BI, and it really has many, many use cases, we used to apply various workarounds previously in order to somehow achieve what should be a normal outcome, in my opinion. So previously, we were creating two visuals, overlaying one another, playing with transparency settings of one of them, and in order to make them work as a totals on the top of the stacked column chart. And I have to admit that it was quite awkward, and I would say painful for development. But huge things sometimes happen by an accident, and that's exactly what happened to me here. So while I was working on a Power BI report and simply needed to use stacked column chart visual to properly articulate some numbers, I was, you know, mentally preparing for another round of painful development. And then all of a sudden, solution came out of nowhere. So I already had on my report canvas a simple line visual, which had data labels turned on. That's important, so bear with me. While looking at this report, I started to click up and down on the stroke width property within shapes, and I clicked all the way down to zero. So I was shocked. I thought that this value must be greater than zero, but it appeared that I was so wrong. And luckily, I was wrong. So what happened? Line just disappeared and data labels were still there. So that gave me an idea to try something with this bug or a feature, call it whatever you want, to solve my original problem. So I will now show you in Power BI Desktop how it's done. Here, I already created a nice stacked column chart, which displays sales amount per month and broken down per product class. So the looks economy and regular, as you see. As you can easily notice, I'm missing here totals per month to get the full picture. OK, so first thing I'm going to do is to switch from this stacked column chart to line and stacked column chart visual. Nothing happened once you click on it. So we are first step is to drag this sales amount measure to line values. you can spot that we now have sales amount measured twice, once here in column values and once in line values. It's fine. Just for the sake of clarity, I will rename this one to total. Okay. And now start the real thing. Go to formatting pane under shapes, as I mentioned, stroke width property. So that's the key property for you. Stroke width set to zero. And voila, line just disappeared. Going to format a little bit, data labels. So I want to customize series. So this option, and I want to customize my total. Let's turn show background and let's change the color. Of course, you can format whatever you like. This is just for the demo purposes, some basic formatting. And one more important thing to do here is to set this position property. Let me find it here. So position instead of auto, you want to check above. Why I'm doing this? Because in this way, I will be sure that my total values will be displayed over data bars. So no matter what is the size of my data bars, total values will be, in any case, displayed above them. So that's the final thing you need to do here. And yeah, the main takeover here is, instead of messing around with complex development, we were able to provide fully functional solution with literally few clicks. As I often like to say, Power BI is full of hidden gems, and sometimes you find them after long research, but sometimes they appear simply by an accident, like in this case. And let's hope that Microsoft don't remove this bug or a feature, whatever, because it will make our life much easier if it stays here. Okay, going back to presentation. Next thing I want to talk about is using buttons for drilling through. First of all, drill through action is a relatively new feature in Power BI. In March this year, it was announced as a preview feature, and since May 2020, it became generally available. I really consider this as a huge thing, since I really have a lot of users who are not aware of drill through feature at all. Previously, they needed to right-click on the visual and choose to drill through to a specific page, which was not so intuitive. So I had to create a different workarounds. If you recall our demo for animated tooltips, this was one of the solutions to point user into direction of using drill through. Now, having specific drill through action enabled for our buttons with little decks and with proper formatting, we can dynamically set properties of the buttons and create really awesome experience for our users. And awesome experience for your users in most cases means that they will love you. So it's showtime again. Let's go to Power BI Desktop. Let's insert a blank button for the beginning. And I need to do some basic formatting. Let's first insert text. So it will be open drill through page. We will customize this later, so it's not so important at the moment. And since I want this button to follow the overall design of my report, I'll make it blue. And I like round edges. You don't need to set everything like me. It's just my preference. Okay, so next thing, because I have multiple different drill through pages in my report, which are already created, let me just briefly show you. It's sales amount color, which shows, like in one of previous examples, sales amount broken down by color for selected brand, and sales amount brand, which shows total amount in dollars broken down by brand in specific point of time. Okay, so you will get everything, no worries, just to hold. And I want to give my users possibility to choose what kind of details they would like to see. So therefore, I need to create a small table which will hold data about my drill through pages. Again, going to drill to enter data, and I will call this table drill through pages. Again, using two columns, ID for the same purpose, to in case you want to sort your records in different order than alphabetically. And then the second one is page. Let's The most important thing here, I need to emphasize this, is to that your names in this table must exactly match your pages name. So my pages are sales amount color and sales amount brand. Okay, let's load this to our data model. Okay, so I will now drag a slicer to my report. Okay, and put selected little two pages. Okay, and put page here. Okay, and the important thing is under selection controls. So here, single select, turn on. I will explain why. So now we have give our users option to select which kind of detail they want to see. Depending on selection, we want to dynamically adjust text on the button here, so that user knows where he or she should be navigated. Therefore, I need to create a measure. I will call it selected page, and it equals, it's just a basic string concatenation. We will just use a selected value function to capture the value from the slicer. So it's from drill through pages page. Okay. Basically, this will dynamically change the button text. So go to format button, and under button text, you see here this small FX button. So I will click on it, and based on field, I will choose my selected page. Now you can see that open sales amount shows me the name of my page, open sales amount brand. Once I click on sales amount color, it adjusts to show open sales amount color. So that works fine. And next step is to instruct our button what to do depending on user selection. So again, we are going to formatting pane and going to action property, turn it on. Now, instead of bookmark, we will choose drill through action. And for this destination, again, choosing FX button and choosing page. We will leave this default first summarization here because that's completely fine. Since we defined user selection to exclusively one value within our slicer, we don't need to worry whatever user selects. This will be the first and the only selection. Okay, so as you see, our button is now grayed out. That means that user can assume that it's in disabled state. It doesn't work, do anything. So once I click on it, nothing happens. But I'm getting a message to drill through to sales amount brand, select a single data point from year or month. So now when I click on, let's say, March 2009, my button becomes blue and I can click on it. And I'm being navigated to a drill through page, which shows me sales amount for the selected period, which is March 2009. Going back to my main page, the button is grayed out again. Let's now check for May 2009, for example. Once I click on it, a button is ready for an action. I click on it and I see numbers for May 2009. Once I switch to sales amount by color, you see that the text is dynamically adjusted. And when I click on the button, I get a message to choose a single data point from data name. Let's do this. I click on Wide World Importers. My button becomes blue, clicking on it, and I see sales amount by color for Wide World Importers. So my filters are being passed to drill through page. Let's check for Contoso if it works again. So open sales amount color, and I see sales amount by color for Contoso. So I would say that everything works fine. As you saw in this demo, with some basic decks, we were able to dynamically format our button, and with tweaking button actions, we enabled our users to navigate through multiple drill-through pages. At the same time, we avoided complexity of creating and maintaining multiple bookmarks. Okay, last one. Here we are again, back to slicers and bookmarks, which work perfectly in synergy. Now the problem we are trying to solve, or it's not a problem per se, but more of an enhancement to our users' experience. But let's say that we have many slicers in our report, which is a pretty common situation in real life. And our users have chosen different values in each of those slicers to filter the data. Now they want to go back where they started and clean slicer selection. Option number one, obviously, is to go and clear selection in all slicers one by one, but that's quite cumbersome and tedious. And therefore, I will now show you a very simple trick how to reset all the slicers with only one single click. So no matter how many of slicers you have in your report, 3, 5, 10, one single click will be enough to revert them to level zero. So let's head over to Power BI desktop again. Okay. First, I will put again blank button on our report. Again, do some basic formatting. Here we will have text reset all. Again, make it blue. Don't yell at me. I like blue color in this report. And round edges. That's fine. Make it a little bit larger. Okay. Now what we need to do is to create a bookmark which will capture this status of our report page. So going to view, turning on bookmarks and selection pane, and I will add a new bookmark. Let's call it slicer pane reset. Okay. Bear with me, now follows the most important thing for this to work. Previously, we were unchecking data option, but we now don't want to do that. We will leave it checked, as you see here. I'll leave it checked. And that will capture the current state of this page, including all the selections within the slicers. So once we navigate back to this state via bookmark, it will also transfer capture data, which is in our case the state where all slicers are set to default. So finally, let's check if everything works here as expected. Now let's define action for this button to navigate me to this bookmark. So slicer pane reset. Okay, and now let me select a few brands here. Contoso, Fabricam, Northwind Traders, okay. If I click on reset all, you see that my slicer was reset to start. Okay, let's check with the multiple different slicers. If I choose here 2008, 2009, and let's say April, June, and August, and I want to see numbers for Contoso and Fabricam and Southridge Video. So now imagine your user want to go from the scratch. So he needs to go through every single slicer and clean all the selections. So it's quite cumbersome. Now, just with clicking on reset all, he's back to where he started. Absolutely perfect. As you witnessed, with some basic knowledge of bookmarks, we were able to significantly improve user's experience. Believe me, I applied this technique in multiple reports, and every single time my users were truly grateful because they were now able to achieve with one click something that previously required multiple clicking here and there, and it was annoying for them. Okay, guys, I'm looking forward to hearing your questions now. In case there is not enough time to answer all of them, I will collect all the questions and post answers on my blog, or I will find a way to get back to you with the answers. And one last thing from my side, while answering the questions, may I kindly ask you to fill the survey about today's session. I would really appreciate your feedback. The survey link, I will put it now in chat window. So once again, if you can spend a few minutes filling it, that will truly help to improve the session quality in the future. Let me just put the link in chat. So survey.
Yeah,
Thanks in advance. Really appreciate it.
That's very important for everyone. And don't just put numbers in if there are any comment fields. Yeah, you have something else to tell me. Use that question number 9 with like extra information. Why was it fantastic? It was fantastic. But why was it? Because that helps a lot to know what to emphasize. And if there are details to fix, then it's really good to just add more information than just do the numbers.
Exactly.
We have some questions coming into the chat. First of all, we had lots of things like thank you for making it look so easy, and for me as a complete Power BI noob, I could still follow the presentation and kind of understand what you do. My problem is I can't even draw a straight line if I use a ruler, so I would still ask someone to design the report. But you make it look very, very easy, and thanks for that.
You're welcome. That was the purpose, to let people know that they can do exactly the same in their Power BI development. So it's nothing complex and complicated.
We have one question here. How do you share your Power BI page when you created all the slicers to the end users?
When I create all slicers,
I think it's more about how do you share the Power BI report.
Well, basically, you can share Power BI report in multiple different ways. My company using on-premises solutions, so we are using Power BI desktop for report server. Therefore, you just save your PBIX file to a Power BI report server. And the other option, which is most common, is Power BI service. Basically, you are publishing your PBIX file to a cloud, and then depending on access rights, specific users can access specific reports. So basically, you are creating data sets on your Power BI service, and then from these data sets, different reports, users can create different reports by themselves.
Yeah, and these days, I guess everything is so interconnected, so you could put it in Teams or whatever, as long as you have a connection
exactly.
to the actual data
sources. You can embed
sources.
It. There is also option to embed it in the application, so you well said that everything is integrated, more or less.
Patrick is asking, thank you, Nick, do you have any docs to share afterwards summarizing steps, formulas? And for me, I would
sure.
point them to your blog, probably.
Sure. Either on blog or, I can put them somewhere and share the link with all the attendees who are interested in that.
Yeah. And the presentation, it doesn't contain the actual demos, and I guess the PBIX file that you use is not so easy to just around.
Yeah, it's not a problem. It's just a raw file with starting from scratch. So the only option is if I share both starting file and finishing file. So, but I think the video which you will upload to a channel, it's more appropriate to follow all the steps. It's not a problem for me to share the files, but I think it's more convenient for people to follow through the video.
Yeah. There is a question about sharing. Where will the video be shared? So I'm just going to take over the screen share. And on this page, SQL or SQL, depending on what your flavor, how do you want to call it, but SQLFriday.net. If you click on past sessions, you will find all the previous presentations. So we can see Neil, who I talked to last Friday, and Guy. And there is the YouTube video embedded on all these ones. And the video from today's presentation is going to come up on YouTube and on this page, probably tonight, maybe tomorrow, early tomorrow. I try to just get it done as soon as possible because I don't want to have like bad conscience for not finishing stuff. So,
yeah, just from my side, people go to SQL Friday YouTube channel. There are a lot of great resources and great videos from real experts.
Yeah, and it's I try to keep it, pretty wide. So data platform, we have had everything from Cosmos DB to Power BI to really down to the details in the database engine. And so it's something for all flavors. I'm a SQL Server guy, so that's what I kind of understand the most. But I loved your presentation, and I understand why you got such great reviews from New Stars of Data.
Thanks.
I think we'll get today too. So.
Thanks. I appreciate both positive and even more negative opinions, because that will help me to improve the session in the future.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
I think that will be the ending words, because I need to run off for a work meeting.
Sure.
Unfortunately, there's paid work too.
Yeah. Once more, thanks for having me today, Magnus. It was really a pleasure to present. And thanks to all who attended the session. And I wish you a nice rest of the day and forthcoming weekend.
Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciated it.
Thank you.
Hope to see you in some in-person event in not too long. We never know when that happens.
Yeah, hopefully soon. Hopefully soon. Me too.
Yes.
Have a nice rest of the day. Yeah, you too. Bye.
Bye.
Ciao.